Welcome to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. We pray that this message will strengthen and encourage you. Now, here's a message from Pastor Jim Cobray.
Father, we come to you in the mighty name of Jesus. Lord, we thank you for what you've already done in this house. God, so good to be in your presence. Good to lift up our hands, lift our hearts, lift our voices to you in song and in praise, God. Lord, we don't want to stop there. We want to go farther with you. So we open up your word. God, we pray that you open it up to us. Open us up to receive it, God. Open our eyes to see, our ears to hear. Open our hearts to have a good understanding. May we be the good ground where the word is sown, and may it produce something in each and every one of our individual lives. Holy Spirit, you're welcome in this place. Be our teacher, be our guide. Give us the vision, the wisdom, the instruction, the direction, even the correction that we need for our lives. God, will give you the praise, give you all the glory. Lord, we don't just ask this blessing upon ourselves. Also, we'd ask it for all the churches, both here in the Inland Empire as well as around the planet, that are preaching and hearing your gospel. We bless them this day. Lord, there are brothers and sisters. At no time do we think of ourselves as any better than anybody else, but we see ourselves as co-laborers and workers together in one field, building one kingdom, and that's yours, God. So God, we ask that you bless our Baptist brothers and sisters, Lutherans, Methodists, Episcopalian, Charismatics, Pentecostals. God, we thank you for Calvary Chapel, Harvest, for Oak Valley, for the Well on the Way, for Ecclesia and Trinity and Emmanuel Baptist, God. All the great churches that are out there, too many to name by name. God bless the Adventists, God, and the Catholic brothers and sisters, Lord. We bless Victory, God, and the Assemblies, Lord, and the Foursquare denominations. All the great churches out there that are preaching your gospel and your truth, lifting up your name, Jesus. They're our brothers and sisters, and we love them, Lord. We bless them as you would bless us. In Jesus' mighty name, we're all in agreement. We say,
amen.
Amen. Today, get your Bibles out and go with me to Hebrews, the 10th chapter. We're going to be continuing our studies in Hebrews, the 10th chapter. Now, we're going to go back over some verses. Pastor Jim kind of alluded to this last week when he said that he gave the teaching team free rein to go back over these verses. And I view it this way. If you think about a house, if you're building a house, when you put the drywall up, you're not done with that drywall. No, there's a top coat that has to go on that, then there's a texture that has to go over that, then there's paint that has to go over that. And there's many applications in the same place just to get a wall done. In the same way, the Word of God is so rich that I'm not going over these verses again because they were lacking anything in their messages or because they didn't do a good job. It was phenomenal. It was outstanding. I would encourage you to get a hold of those because we're going to build on those same principles that we had talked about. It's going to dovetail right in with what was going on. And that's one of the neat things about a teaching team is not only the diversity, but also the fact that we can come and we can bring things, and it's always fresh here in the house of God. So we're going to be in Hebrews, the 10th chapter, verse number 36 through verse number 38. Now, while you're getting ready for that, let me give you the title of today's message for those of you that are taking notes. The title of today's message is Patient Endurance. Now, I thought that was going to happen. You could have heard a pin drop outside right now. Same thing happened in the first service. Y'all said on the inside, there's going to be an oh me message, not an amen message. Because none of us likes being patient. None of us wants to endure. And yet, the Word of God is very clear that it's very necessary in our lives. Let's take a look at it in Hebrews, the 10th chapter, verse number 36 through verse number 38. Take a look at it with me. Hebrews, the 10th chapter, verse 36 says this. It says, "For you have need of endurance." Look at your neighbor and say, "I need endurance." Look at your other neighbor and say, "He's right," or "She's right." "For you have need of endurance, so that after you have done the will of God, you may receive the promise." Verse 37, "For yet a little while, and he who is coming will come and will not tarry." Verse number 38, "Now the just shall live by faith, but if anyone draws back, my soul has no pleasure in him." Now, back to verse number 36, you see, it says, "For you have need of endurance." That word endurance, maybe you're reading the Old King James Version. We study from the King James Version, but we preach and teach from the New King James Version. But the King James Version says, in the place of endurance, it says patience. Patience. That's why I titled the message Patient Endurance. You say, "Well, which one is it, Pastor?" Yes, that's the answer. Yes, it is. Okay? It's both. See, the original word for endurance is a compound word meaning to remain under. In other words, if I had a burden, a heavy load, that I was to pick up and I was to place on my back, and I was going to go to a destination with that burden on my shoulders, in order for me to patiently endure, I would have to remain under that load. I would have to carry it all the way with me. Now, if I drop that load off my back, I've no longer patiently endured. Now, I've given up on it, and I won't reach my destination with what I need. Now, the English definitions agree with this. Webster defined patience as the power of suffering with fortitude. You say, Pastor, what does fortitude mean? I had the same question, so I had to look it up. Fortitude means courage in pain or adversity. See, sometimes we see pain ahead. We see a trial ahead. We know it's going to cost us something. We know it's going to hurt. We know that it's going to take more than we know. So we're going to have to study. We're going to have to learn something. We look at the road ahead and we see the pain of the process in order to get to the promise. But if we're going to get there, we're going to have courage to go through that pain or that adversity. Why? Because if you can make it through the pain of the process, then you'll get to the promise. Are you listening today? Also, Webster defined it as this: uncomplaining endurance of evils or wrongs. See, sometimes we get a little poke. Life comes and squeezes us, and out of us comes the wrong things. Something happens. There's an evil or there's a wrong that happens. Something takes place. And rather than praise God in the midst of it, rather than hold on to our confession, rather than just continue to bear that load and not let it affect us, we start to complain. Oh, God, what have you brought me to? Why are we doing this? God, why can't anything ever be easy, Lord? See, I've said that too. That's why I can bring all these things out. Okay, so I'm not just picking on you. I'm picking on me. Now, the Oxford Dictionaries define it as this: the capacity to accept or tolerate delay, suffering, or trouble without getting angry. Let me read that again. The capacity to accept or tolerate delay, suffering, or trouble without getting angry. See, we can accept delay or suffering or trouble if we can get angry. Oh, I'll take it, but man, I'm not going to like it. And I'm going to let everybody know how I feel about it, too. Just the other day, I had a personal project I was working on, and I had some things going. It's been years through this process that we've been trying to get this thing going. And I finally got from the company I'm working with, I finally got, you know, my first one. And I'm looking at it. I'm going through it. I'm going over it. And as I'm going through it, I'm going, this is not the quality that I would expect. This is not what I signed up for. And on the inside, I'm just getting angry. Like, I'm just done with this. I'm done with them. I'm done with the process. I'm ready to give up and go do something else. And yet on the inside, I had to stop myself and say, no, don't get angry. Don't give up. Don't quit. You're going to have to bear this load, and you're going to have to go through it once again and make sure that you're putting out the right thing. Because the wrong thing is to just give up or to just say, oh, well, fine, that's just it. Let's go for it, you know. Or to accept something less than what I believe is the excellence of God. And therefore, I had to stop and I had to just cast my care on the Lord and say, God, you know, I'm giving this to you, Lord. I'm not going to get angry about it, Lord. I'm just going to go. I'll go back to the company. I'll work with them once again. I'm going to go another round with them. But it's okay, God. I'm believing you for favor. I'm believing you. It's not going to cost me more money, God. I'm believing you that it's just going to come to pass and that it's going to happen quickly. We'll be able to resolve this. It'll be just a quick and easy process. I'm believing for that. But now I'm gearing myself up that if I have to endure pain or if I have to go through the process or the trial, that I'm going to bear that load. Why? Because I want the promise. I want the product on the other side. See, in our lives, we got to make sure that we go through that without getting angry, without allowing ourselves. See, the Bible says, be angry, but do not sin. So you got to cast your care on the Lord. You got to give it to God, and you got to bear that load patiently, and you have to endure it, remain under it, stay in the game, if you will. So today is one thing for me to tell you what to do. But it's quite a different thing for me to tell you how to do it. See, don't you want to know how to do this? See, I could come and say, patiently endure it. And you could say, well, that must mean that I just sit there and do nothing. Well, no, that's not really the case. Or you might be thinking, well, that just means that I just go and make everything happen. Now, while both of those have some validity to them, no, we need to define for us from the Word of God, how do we patiently endure? Anybody want to find out today? All right, praise the Lord. How to patiently endure. A couple of things for us today. Number one, how to patiently endure is this. Don't fret. Don't fret. Say, don't fret. What does that mean, Pastor? Let me define it to you like this. Don't worry. What good is worrying going to do? See, Jesus asked that same question. He said, which of you by worrying can add an inch to your stature? You can't just worry and grow an inch. You know, it doesn't work like that. He said, you can't even change the color of your hair by worrying. Now, modern day, we can change it by dying, but we can't change it by worrying, right? Is that true? Okay, ladies? No, I won't pick on anybody today. Pastor, you don't know. But see, worrying is not going to get us there. Worrying is not going to make it happen. Worrying is not going to do the job. All worrying is going to do is going to stress you out, and that's unhealthy. There have been studies that have shown that stress will actually take away from your life rather than add to your life. So don't fret. That word fret's an interesting word. As I was researching it, it had the connotation of a mist that was coming off the ocean and producing a fog. See, sometimes when we start to patiently endure, when we see the promise of God and we start to look at where we want to go with God, it's almost as if worry comes in like a fog and starts to block our view and cloud out what we would see as the promises of God. And yet, when you cast your care on the Lord and when you get out of worry and doubt, now all of a sudden, it's like this morning when I woke up and I was driving here, I could see the wind blowing the trees, but guess what else I could see? I could see the mountains. I could see far into the valley. Why? Because that wind had come through and it had blown away all of the smog, all of the marine layer, all that was pushed away, and now I could see crystal clear. See, in the same way, if you don't allow worry to come in, but you allow the Spirit of God to come and breathe and to come and speak and to minister to your heart, you will be able to see a clear vision of what you're believing God for and be able to carry and bear that burden, remain under the pressure. Today we're going to be playing in the book of James and the book of Hebrews. We'll be going back and forth. Nice thing is they're right next to each other. So turn with me just a couple pages back to the book of James, chapter number 5. James chapter number 5. We're going to take a look at two verses, verse number 7 and verse number 8. James chapter 5, verse number 7, starting out says this. It says, therefore, be patient, brethren. Now, let me ask you something. Who are the brethren? We are, right? So this is talking to you, and this is talking to me. So when the Word of God comes along and says, therefore, be patient, brethren, he's talking to us. So we ought to pay attention. Therefore, be patient, brethren, until the coming of the Lord. And then he gives us a natural example to help us to do this. Look at what he says. See how the farmer waits for the precious fruit of the earth, waiting patiently for it until it receives the early and the latter rain. Now, in our society, we are not a agricultural society. We're not a farming society by and large. Most of us, when we want fruits or we want vegetables, what do? We go to the store and we get it. And we don't stop to think about that this fruit is not in season right now. You want strawberries, you can get strawberries. You want peaches, you can get peaches. You want mangoes, you can get mangoes. Why? Because somewhere in the world, they have found out that the seasons are switching. They're flip-flopped, right? So if it's not the season up here in North America, what do? They go to South America. They go to Argentina. They go to Chile. They go to the different places down there. And they farm these fruits and vegetables, and then they ship them up to us so that we can enjoy them. So we have this mentality with the things of God that, hey, it's always in season, right? Oh, we're just going to go get it. But listen, God is not a supermarket in the sky that we go and we get what we need. No, there are seeds that we have to sow. There are things that we have to do. There's things that have to take place. And we got to take our notes from the farmer who waits. Oh, we don't like waiting in our society. I want it now, instant, on demand. I want it in 30 seconds or less, or it's free, right? I want to have it now. I want to have it my way. And yet God is saying, see how the farmer waits for the precious fruit of the earth, waiting patiently, remaining under it until it receives the early and latter rain. You know what that is talking about? That's the seasons. That's the spring rains and the fall rains. That's the early rains and the latter rains. And you know what happens in between? When that farmer sows that seed, he covers it up with earth, and does he see anything? No. For the most part, he doesn't see nothing. It's just a dirt field. The weeds are growing up, but where's my plants? I'm having to work, and I'm having to cultivate the soil. I'm having to put the nutrients down. I'm having to make sure that everything's right and looking over it. But it's unseen. See, sometimes in the Word of God, you get a hold of a promise of God, and you find out something about your life. Man, I can be healed. And you start to speak the Scriptures. You start to believe God for it, and nothing happens. You know what's happening is you've sown a seed. And now you don't see it, and you're waiting for it to come to fruition in your life. We look at other people's lives and we say, well, how come they're getting blessed? How come they got their promise? I mean, it's in season for them. But listen, they might be in the southern hemisphere while you're in the northern hemisphere. And God says, it's not your season yet, child. You need to wait. You need to wait for the early rain and the latter rain, and maybe you got the early rain, but you still haven't experienced the latter rain. I'm here to tell you, church, wait patiently. Why? Because the latter rain is coming. God will bring it to pass in its time and in its season. Look at verse number 8. You also, in other words, just like the farmer, you also be patient. Establish your hearts, for the coming of the Lord is at hand. I read a story about William Wilberforce. Many of you have seen the movie Amazing Grace, and you remember him. He was one of the lawyers and one of the godly men who went up against the slave trade in England. Young William Wilberforce was discouraged one night in the early 1790s after another defeat in his 10-year battle against the slave trade in England. Tired and frustrated, he opened his Bible and began to leaf through it. A small piece of paper fell out and fluttered to the floor. It was a letter written by John Wesley shortly before his death. Wilberforce read it again, said these words, "Unless the divine power has raised you up, I see not how you can go through your glorious enterprise in opposing that abominable practice of slavery, which is the scandal of religion, of England, and of human nature. Unless God has raised you up for this very thing, you will be worn out by the opposition of men and devils. But if God be for you, who can be against you? Are all of them together stronger than God? Oh, be not weary of well-doing. Go on in the name of God and in the power of his might." Don't fret. Are you listening today? God is good. God is good. How to patiently endure. Thank you for these three holy claps this morning. Praise God. We'll get the rest of you guys. We'll get you by the end of the church service. It's okay. It's okay. All right. Praise the Lord. First one is don't fret. Second thing, how do we patiently endure? Second one for today is this. Don't fear. Don't fear. Back to Hebrews, the 10th chapter. Hebrews, the 10th chapter, verse number 38 this time. Very first part of the verse. Look at what it says. Now the just shall live by faith. Now, I'm not going to take too much time on this one because we're about ready to go to Hebrews, the 11th chapter. Okay? And in Hebrews, the 11th chapter, we're so excited because that is the faith chapter. We're going to be eating faith, drinking faith, breathing faith, sleeping faith, running faith. I mean, we're going to have so much faith. It's going to be coming out of our nostrils, coming out of our ears. It's going to be seeping through our pores. We're going to be breathing it. It's going to smell in our breath. I mean, it's just going to be oozing out of us. We're going to have so much faith in this place, okay? So I'm going to take a little bit of time, but I want to point out to you today that it says that the just shall live by faith. Faith is what moves goods and services in the kingdom of God. Faith is what takes a hold of the unseen supernatural realm and brings it into the seen natural realm. See, that's how we live our lives. Just like we don't see what's going on underneath the ground, we've sown the seed, but by faith, we believe that now that we have planted that seed, that God is going to work on it and that he's going to bring it to pass and to fruition in our lives. It moves heaven and earth. And yet fear in the kingdom of darkness is what moves goods and services in the devil's economy. See, fear will move you off of your faith. It still gets you to move, but it gets you to move in the wrong direction, away from the promises of God. I don't know if I can do this. I don't know if I have enough resources. I don't know if I have enough strength. And now all of a sudden, fear is moving you away from what you were believing God for. But the just shall not live by fear. We don't move anything by fear. No, the just shall live by faith. In other words, I don't see it. I can't calculate it. I don't know how it's going to come to pass. I don't know what to do. I'm not smart enough. I'm not nice enough, cool enough. I don't have enough strength or money or resource to do it. But I know and I believe the promise of God, and therefore God's going to bring it to pass in his time. Hallelujah. I've heard it said that the value of a postage stamp lies in its ability to stick to one thing until it reaches its destination. Is that true? See, that's your life. Stick to it. Stick to faith. Stick to the promise of God. Stick to believing God. Stick to those things. Don't let fear come and yell in your face and get you off of that thing. You tell that fear to take a jump in a fiery lake, go back to hell, devil, where you came from. I'm going on with God. James chapter 1, you were there in Hebrews. The 10th chapter, turn over to James chapter number 1. We'll come back to Hebrews, the 10th chapter in a second. But James chapter 1, right off the bat, James writes, as he writes his letter, he starts out his letter. Look how he starts his letter. Look at this. Verse number 2, James chapter 1, verse number 2. My brethren, again, who's that talking to? Talking to us. My brethren, count it all joy when you fall into various trials. Now, this is so opposite of what we act like all the time. I know for me, I just confessed, man, problem happened, I got angry. I wasn't counting nothing joy. I was counting up how much money I'd already spent and how much time I'd wasted and all this other stuff. But he's saying count it all joy. In other words, a trial comes into your life and you roll your head back and you get a good gut belly laugh going. Why? Why? Next verse, verse number 3. Knowing. See, we ought to know something about this. Knowing that the testing of your faith produces, what are we talking about today? Patience. Patient endurance, remaining under the pressure of the problem. See, the moment you start to believe God, the test starts. The moment you say, you know what, I'm going to stand on the word of God, the devil sees you raised up, and he all of a sudden says, there's a target, right, and tries to take you down. The moment you say, I'm going to believe God in my finances, you know what, I'm going to trust God. Today's the day I'm going to tithe. The moment you start to tithe, it's almost like the bottom falls out. Where'd all the money go? Why? Because the devil never had a problem with you lacking without tithing. But once you start to tithe and believe God, he knows that God's going to start resourcing you and blessing you, and therefore he's going to attack your finances. The moment you say, you know what, I don't have to put up with this sickness any longer, you start to believe God for your health, what happens? Now all of a sudden you had one pain, now you got pains all over it. What on earth? This never hurt, ow, you know, and you're like, what's going on? See, the devil's going to come and attack you. That's why the word says that in the parable of the sower, the word is sown, and immediately the devil comes and tries to steal it all away. Then every day, like the sun rising, persecution arises for the word's sake. And then the weeds and the cares of this life and the desire for other things grow up and try and choke the word. See, there's things that are going to come against you, but if you know it beforehand, you can count it all joy, knowing something, knowing that the testing of your faith produces something, and that is patience. Hallelujah. Produces patience. Look at verse number 4, but let patience have its perfect work. Stay in there. Go through the pain of the process. Why? That you may be perfect and complete, lacking nothing. You know what you were lacking before? Patience. But now that you've gone through the test and the trial, you know what you have? Patience. You're perfect and complete, lacking nothing. You have need of endurance. That's what you were lacking. But now that you've gone through the pain of the process and you remained under it, the testing of your faith has produced in you patience. Wow, so cool. Think about it this way, okay? This will help some of you guys. I know it's helped me. Think about it this way. A teacher only talks before or after a test. But during the test, they're silent. Is that right? You guys remember your school days? I got a school teacher on the front row. Ms. Robin, do you talk during tests? No, for the most part, no, right? Maybe a little encouragement, you can do it, go for it, you know, you got this, you know this. Ms. Sotomayor, do you talk during the test? No, see, all my teachers are saying, no, I don't talk, I'm quiet during the test. See, sometimes we go, oh, Teresa, sorry, do you talk during the test? No, high school teacher, right? No, you're very quiet during the, and you're telling everybody else shut up too, put your phones down, okay? So, yeah, Dr. Kobenig was here in the first service. See, all the teachers say, no, during the test, we're quiet. Sometimes we're going through a test and we say, where's God? I haven't heard his voice in so long. God, why, Lord, why? Why have you forsaken me, God? I'm here all by... But God's saying, no, you've already heard the information you need. You've already got the word. You read the book. See, it's an open book test. You got your Bible out, right? Sword up, shield out. So you've already got everything you need to pass the test. And after the test, God will come and he'll talk to you about what's next. He'll teach you some more. He'll tell you what happened. And you know, you'll see the passing grade. He'll tell you, you can do this better next time. This was good. This was encouraging. This is where you need to be. All that kind of stuff. But during the test, the teacher is often silent. So if you're wondering where God is, maybe God's standing there waiting for you to pass the test. Now, that doesn't mean God put sickness on you or put lack on you or put fear on you. No, that's not it. But God will take a look, because now you've raised up and you said, I'm going to believe God for this. And now the devil comes against you and you say, where's God? God's right there. God's waiting for you to go for it. God's waiting for you to believe his promise. God's looking at your life and saying, you can do this, child. Stand up. Fight. Go for it. Remain in there. Do not fear, because you can pass the test. Hallelujah. Last one for today. Last one for today. Don't fret. Don't fear. How do we do this? How do we patiently endure? Last one for today. Don't forget. Don't forget. Hebrews, the 10th chapter, once again. Hebrews, the 10th chapter, verse 38. Now the just shall live by faith, but if anyone draws back, my soul has no pleasure in him. If you forget the word of the Lord and you abandon what you know, then God says, my soul has no pleasure in him. Listen, we want to live a life that's pleasing to God. When God looks at our lives, we want to see a smile on his face. And therefore, church, we shouldn't fret, shouldn't worry, shouldn't fear, no doubting, no unbelief, but also we shouldn't forget. See, the only way that you cannot receive the promise of God is if you get off of it. Devil can't stop you. World can't stop you. My goodness, nothing can stop you. And yet, you can stop you. How? Because you forget the promise of God and you abandon what you know and what you believe to be true. Jay Stoll, in his book Fan the Flame, described the Greeks had a race in their Olympic Games that was unique. The winner was not the runner who finished first, but it was the runner who finished with his torch still lit. See, that talks about patient endurance. We have to fan the flame sometimes. We have to remind ourselves, this is what God spoke to me. This is my God assignment. This is my place. God has brought me this far. This is my ground. I have gained this ground. And come hell or high water, you're not going to get me off of this ground. This is where I stand. I'm going to remain under the burden. Doesn't matter how fierce the battle may get, I can take it, because God is on my side. He's equipped me for life. And now we can do this together. Spurgeon preached and adds, by perseverance, the snail reached the ark. It's okay, it took first service a while too. Don't worry about it. But think about that process. How long did it take? What had to happen? Where were they coming from? And coming up that, I imagine that was one of the last ones to get on, right? Here at the end of the train, all the elephants, you know, the cheetahs were in there first, you know. Gazelles, they just hopped up in. Here comes the snail, and the raindrops are starting, and Noah's standing there going, come on, come on, come on, come on. By perseverance, patient endurance. See, sometimes people say, Pastor, how long should I wait on God? How long, Pastor? How long do I wait? How much do I spend? How much time do I waste? How long do I wait? You want to know the answer? Until you have the promise of God in your hand, or till he calls you home or comes to get you. See, you wait and you hold on to the promises of God until you have it. Until. That's how long you wait. Last verse for today, James, the 5th chapter. Once again, James chapter 5. We're going to drop down into verse number 11 this time. James chapter 5. Verse number 11, take a look at it with me. James chapter 5, verse 11 says this, indeed, we count them blessed who endure. You have heard of the perseverance of Job. You guys remember Job? You guys know Job? If you don't know Job, let me tell you about Job for a second. Job was a great man. This was a man of God. This was a man who prayed every day. It's a man who was very blessed. He had wealth, he had land, he had cattle, he had sheep, he had it going on, he had servants, you know, he had all this stuff. But even more importantly than that, he had a big family that he loved. And he was so blessed, his kids would go and they would eat at each other's houses. He would pray for his children, and he would believe God for them, and he had a really blessed life. Now behind the scenes, the devil comes before the Lord and says, does Job fear you for nothing? You've set a hedge of protection all around and about him. Take away all the stuff that he has. He'll curse you to your face. God says, you really think so? Try it, but don't kill the man. So the devil in one day wipes out all of Job's lands, all of Job's wealth, all of Job's family, all his kids are gone, just like that. And Job maintains his integrity, and he won't curse the Lord. Now, the devil presents himself before God, and God says, see, told you. The devil says, skin for skin, man. Of course he's not going to, but if you go against his physical health, then he'll curse you to your face. God says, go ahead, try it, but don't kill the man. So the devil goes and puts painful boils all over Job's body. I mean, this is just crazy. The word gives us a picture. He's sitting in an ash heap, scraping the boils with potsherds. I mean, that's just disgusting. But that's the position that Job's in. There his wife comes out to him and says, curse God and die. And yet Job says, shall I accept only good from the Lord and not bad? Blessed be the name of the Lord. The Lord giveth and the Lord taketh away. But blessed be the name of the Lord. And he refuses to give up on his integrity. Now, you know the story. His friends come. They have a lengthy conversation. All the friends are saying, Job, you must have done something wrong. You're screwed up. You're messed up, Job. You should know that something, you did something in there, Job. Why don't you just confess it and get it over with, and let's be done with this. Just say it, Job. And Job says, no, I wish I had an umpire, somebody who could go before me and God, and we could converse. But I know that my Redeemer lives, and one day he will stand on the earth. See, he kept his faith, and he was believing God, and kept his fear of the Lord throughout the whole process. Now God shows up on the scene and says, Job, where were you when I was creating the heavens and the earth? And Job says, you're right. I'm wrong. And that's just the end of it. So the Lord goes to Job and says, Job, I want you to pray for your friends. And friends, I want you to listen to Job's prayer, because Job never sinned against me with his mouth. Job never sinned against me with his mouth. He never cursed the Lord. He maintained his integrity throughout it all. He didn't give up. He didn't forget who his God was. Therefore, he prayed for his friends, and as he prayed for his friends, the Bible says that the Lord restored to him double for his trouble. Double the family, double the fields, double the flocks, double the blessing on his life. James, the 5th chapter, verse number 11, indeed, we count them blessed to endure. You have heard of the perseverance of Job and seen the end. What's that next word? I'm sorry. What's that word? What's that word? Intended by the Lord. In other words, God had a plan through the whole thing, already knew what he was going to do, and the devil thought he was cool coming up and trying to take away Job's integrity, and yet God knew something about Job, and God knew that there was an end that he had intended for this story to end with, and therefore God blessed Job, because he didn't forget his God, he didn't give up on his God, the end intended by the Lord, look at it, that the Lord is very compassionate and merciful. See, in your life, if you do not see the end, remember Job. Because even though we may have it bad, I don't think we have it that bad when you start to take a look at his life. But even if it is that bad, God has a plan, God has a direction, God has a purpose, God has an intent, and God wants to get you there, but you got to hold on and not forget who God is, that he is merciful and very compassionate. What did we learn today? How to patiently endure. Number one, we learned don't fret. Don't worry. Don't get in that cloud. Second thing we learned, don't fear. Stick to it. The just shall live by faith. And number three, don't forget. Do not give up on God. If you got something from the word of the Lord today, come on, give God a great big praise. Woo! Hallelujah. I want to thank you guys for staying put. You guys have been great today. For those of you that are in the foyer, you're out there in the bathrooms and down the breezeways, I know I have speakers that you can hear me. I want you to stop right where you're at and listen up. God wants to speak to you where you're at right now as well. I want to talk to you guys about your eternal life. We read the verse today that Jesus is coming. The Lord's coming quickly and he will not tarry. When he comes, or should he call you before that? Because we're only allotted a certain number of days on this earth. Jesus could come back or we could go. And you're only going to end up in one of two places at the end of it all. In either scenario, you're either going to end up in heaven or you're going to end up in hell. Now, sometimes people say, well, Pastor, I don't like hell. You know, I don't agree with hell. I don't believe in hell. And therefore, I'm not going to go there. Well, did you know that just by ignoring something's existence doesn't make it go away? That's like standing on the freeway saying, I don't believe in some of my trucks. Listen, you're going to meet one face to face sooner or later. You keep standing there. And I'm here loving you enough to yell at you, get out of the street. There's a truck coming. Hell is a very real place. Jesus spoke about it in the New Testament, talks about it all throughout the Bible, Old and New Testament. And therefore, just by burying your head in the sand doesn't make it go away. You're going to have to face the reality of it. And I love you enough to tell you the truth today. God loves you so much, he sent Jesus beaten, bloody, and hung on a cross. So you didn't have to go to hell, that you could go in heaven and be with him. Sometimes people say, well, yeah, I understand that, and I agree with that, Pastor. And all roads lead to heaven now because of that. You just do your thing, I'll do my thing. You know, the church is out there and the religion's out there. That as long as we stay true to ourselves, we'll get to heaven somehow, some way. Now, while I wish that were true, it's not. Not at all. Can't just do whatever you want to do, or whatever I say to do, or whatever some well-meaning church committee says to do, and get to go to heaven. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man goes to the Father except by me. Only one way you're going to get to go to heaven. See, it's like saying, well, all roads lead to the moon. No, only one way you're going to get to the moon. You can drive around the earth as long as you want, and you will never make it. In the same way, you can't just do whatever you want to do and expect to get to go to heaven. Don't you think God, the creator of the heavens and the earth, the one who wrote the plan of redemption, carried it out in his son Jesus, don't you think after going to the cross, a public spectacle for all to see, after all that, don't you think he'd tell us how to get to heaven? Well, he does in his word. Sometimes people say, well, Pastor, I get that. I understand that. And, you know, I know God lets good people into heaven. I've been really good. Used to be bad, cleaned up my act. Now I'm good. My good really outweighs my bad, you know, and God sees that and appreciates that. I've given money to charities, helped people out, been nice to my neighbors, and therefore I'm going to go to heaven because of that. But the problem with that thing is, you know that nowhere in the Bible says you can be good enough to get to heaven. In fact, the Bible tells us all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. The standard for heaven is perfection. The only one who is perfect, his name is Jesus. You're not going to get there by your good works. In fact, the Bible says your goodness compared to God's goodness, like filthy rags, going to get thrown out. You're not going to make it by being good. Let me love you enough today to tell you the truth. Sometimes people say, well, Pastor, I get that, but you know, I was raised in church. Parents told me you're Christians growing up. Hung a cross or St. Christopher around your neck. Had you baptized or christened as a child? Took you to religious classes like Sunday school, maybe catechism or Sabbath school class. You're born in America. America's a Christian nation. Everybody born in America is going to heaven. We're not any other religions. We're not Buddhist, Muslim, Hindu. Therefore, we're Christians headed for heaven, denying our presence in hell, right? Wrong. Do you know that nowhere in the Bible say you're raised in church? Parents tell you you're Christian, that makes you a Christian. Nor in the Bible say that because you're born in America that that automatically qualifies you for heaven, or because you're not some other religion that by default God lumps you into the category of being a Christian headed for heaven, denying your presence in hell. You might be thinking, well, Pastor, I get that. Okay, I understand that. But that was when I was a child. Here I am sitting in church in front of you right now. I consider myself to be a Christian. And while I'm glad you're here today, could you just show that to me in the Bible where you sit in church service, call yourself a Christian, that makes you a Christian? It's not there. It's like saying I could go to my garage in my house, call myself a car, and that makes me a car. No, just person sitting in my garage. Same way, you can't just sit in church, call yourself a Christian, that makes you a Christian. You say, but Pastor, hold on, you don't understand. My last church, I got involved. I helped out, sang in the choir, carried the pastor's Bible, made decisions in that church. People thought of me as a leader. Taught in the Bible class, even got a membership card to that church. Says, great, I'm glad you did those things. Could you just show that to me in the Bible? You help out, sing in the choir, make decisions. People think of you as a leader. You get a membership card. God's not looking for your membership card before you can enter the gates of heaven. It doesn't work like that. You say, okay, Pastor, I get that. I got you on this one. I know God. Somebody told me that if I knew God, I'm a Christian. And I know about Jesus, celebrate Easter and the resurrection, sing the songs of Christmas every year of my life. And I can quote scriptures to you. That's great. I'm glad you can do this. And could you just show that to me in the Bible where your head knowledge about who Jesus is gets you into heaven? If you'd read your Bible, you know that demons believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. They're not Christians. If you'd read your Bible, you know the devil himself knows who Jesus is and can quote scriptures out of his mouth, and yet that doesn't qualify him for heaven. So everybody look up here. Look up here. Look at me. It's not about what you have in your head. It's not about having mental assent towards God, knowing who Jesus is, and that gets you right with God. But rather, this is about your heart. All throughout the Bible, God's looking for your heart. Jesus was having a conversation with a religious leader of his day by the name of Nicodemus. Nicodemus was a good guy, did good deeds, raised up in his church called the synagogue. He became one of the leaders. If we would have thought anybody knew God, we would have thought it would have been this guy. He could quote the scripture. He could debate the scripture. Hey, how many of us could do this? He could sing the scripture. Oh my goodness. Probably better than all of us in this room. And yet, when Jesus comes and speaks to this great man, He doesn't pat him on the back and say, Nick, man, hey, you got it going on. Just keep doing what you're doing and I'll see you in heaven. No, he doesn't say that at all. Rather, what does he say? He says, you want to be entering the kingdom of heaven? You must be born again. Now, I know lots of times people turn off when we start using terms like being born again. But listen, this is not a worldly term. This is not something that movies and Hollywood and television and the internet made up, because they make it out to be this weirdo, goofy, crazy Christianity out of control. But listen, let's not let the world define it for us. Let's let the Bible define it for us. What does being born again really mean from the Bible? Well, from the beginning of the Bible to the end of the Bible, it's always meant the same thing. It means that you've given God all of your heart and you've given God all of your life. It's just that simple. It's all or nothing with Jesus. Let me prove it to you. Last book of the Bible, book of Revelation, Jesus is speaking to the church, just like he's speaking to us here in this church today. And he says, when I come, I want to find you hot, or I want to find you cold, because if I find you lukewarm, I'll vomit you from my mouth. Now, those are gross, graphic words from the mouth of Jesus, but what is he talking about, lukewarm? Well, what's that? Well, it's a little in, little out, little up, little down, little token prayer every now and again, an occasional church attendance. God is something in your life, but he's not everything, and you're not opposed to God, but you're not wholehearted for God. Well, listen, if that's your relationship with Jesus, not going to make it. How do I know? Because only people that are not real Christians will be ejected and rejected from the body of Christ. So today I'm going to give you an opportunity. Jesus said this. He said, if you confess me before men, I'll confess you before my Father who is in heaven. But if you deny me, I will deny you. So today, your call, your choice. Here's your opportunity. In a moment, I'm going to count to three just like this. One, two, three. And when I say three, I'm going to pop my hands together. Bang! When you hear the sound of my hands popping together just like that, bang! That's your opportunity to raise your hand. What you're doing by the raising of your hand is you're saying, I want to give God all my heart. I want to give God all my life. I want to be born again, headed for heaven, denying my presence in hell. I'll see your hand go up. I'll count it. You can put it right back down. You might be thinking, whoa, 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 wait a second. Time out. If I raise my hand, I'll be embarrassed. Uh-huh. You might be. Let's push past that embarrassment today. Why? Because think of the trade-off. Isn't it better to be embarrassed for a moment than it is to end up in hell forever and ever and ever? No one make that trade. And yet the devil's come and try and talk you out of it right now. You tell the devil to go jump in a fiery lake. You're going on with God. Probably won't even be embarrassed. But even if you are, it's better than ending up in hell. Listen, no one's judging you, criticizing you, condemning you. We're all on your side. We've all done this at one point or another, in one way or another. Now it's your turn. Will you give them all of your heart? Will you give them all of your life? Who should raise their hand in a moment? If you've been running from God instead to God, I'm speaking to you. Who should raise their hand if you're not sure about your salvation? Today, come on, don't leave this place unsure. Make sure before you leave. Who should raise their hand if you've never done this, never said yes to Jesus, given him all of your heart and all of your life? I'm speaking to you. Or finally, who should raise their hand in this place? If you're lukewarm in this place, you know that's the condition of your heart when I described it. Get ready to get your hand up. All across this auditorium, back in the family rooms, wherever you're at, watching by television, in the foyer, the Love Rock Cafe, or online across the nation and around the world. Get ready. God sees right where you're at. If you're on campus, tell an usher or come into the church service right afterwards, or if you're online, click the button that says respond to God next to your browser, or go to our homepage, How to Know God, and someone will lead you in a prayer. I'm going to count to three. Pop my hands together. This is your time. This is your moment of salvation. Here we go. All together on the count of three. One, two, three. Let me see your hands. Just raise them up high for me right now. Thank you. There's one. There's two. There's three. God bless you guys. Where are you at? Raise them up high for me. There's three wise people already. Three wise people already. Who else today? Who else today? Up on top, there's four. Got you up there. Thank you. Thank you. Come on. Come on. Where are you at? I think I got you. I'll count you again anyways. Five, okay? God bless you. Six, seven, eight. Got you over there on this side. Nine, got you over there. Thank you. God bless you. If I don't see you, give me a little wave. Give me a little movement, okay? If you don't think I saw you, right, I got you right there. Thank you, my brother. Anybody else real quick? Back in the family room? Okay, thank you. Oh, got you up there. God bless you. Who else today? Who else today? Thank you right there. Thanks for the wave. Praise God. God is good. Anybody else real quick? You're saying, yeah, I know I need to do this. Come on, just raise it up high for me. Anybody else real quick? Anybody else real quick? Just raise it up high. Thank you. Over there, got you. There, God bless you. On this side. All right. Anybody else real quick? About 9 or 10 wise people. Anybody else real quick? I know there's more than 9 or 10. If you need to do this, come on, go for it. Anybody else? I already got that one. Thank you. Anybody else real quick? Come on, come on, come on. If you know the Spirit of the Lord's tugging at your heart right now and you're saying, I wonder if I should do this. Yeah, God's speaking to you. Go for it. Just lift your hand up. Anybody else real quick in this place? Come on. Come on, just raise it up high for me. Anybody else? Anybody else? Anybody in the top section back there? Anybody in this section on this side? Thank you. Got you over there. Over here. Where you at? Anybody else? I got you. Thank you. Who else? Who else today? Anybody else? All right, let's give the Lord a great big praise. About a dozen wise people. Hallelujah. Now listen, those of you that raised your hand, or you should have raised your hand, but you didn't, it's not too late. Once you get a hold of your coat, purse, sweater, Bible, a friend if you need a friend. Well, once you get in the aisle and meet me up front, because we're going to change destinies today, but we can't do that until we get you down here. Now listen, listen, listen. Even if you didn't raise your hand, but you know you should have, you haven't missed out yet, you can come during this time. So let's all stand. No one leaves during this time. Let's let them come, and let's welcome them. You come right now. Just make your way to the front. If you raise your hand, or you should have raised your hand, get in the aisle and meet me up front right now. Come on. Come on down. From the family rooms, bring your children. They'll remember this. Come on down. They're coming. Come on, let's give them a hand as they come. You can come too. They're still coming. Come on. This is your time. This is your moment of salvation. Hallelujah. You can come too. Come on down. Make your way to the front right now. Anybody else, if you need to come, you just make your way to the front right now. Come on down. Come on down. Come on down. Oh, they're still coming. Come on. They're still coming from the family rooms. Come on down. Come on, let's give the Lord a great big praise. Let's encourage them. You can come too. This is your time. This is your moment. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Well, as they're still coming, come on up, guys. Anybody else, if you need to come while I'm talking, you can come right now. Just make your way in the aisle and come up, meet me up front. Hey, guys, up front, praise God. This is the best decision of your entire life. A whole lot more than a dozen of you up here. So I don't know how to count, or maybe you didn't raise your hand. Either way, I'm excited, okay? God's good. Now, listen, listen. Right over here to my right, your left. See this guy waving at you? This is Pastor Joel. He's a really good guy. Nothing weird's going to go on, okay? Sometimes you go to church, you wonder, are they weird? Nah, you already got past me. I'm about as weird as you're going to encounter today. He's cool. He's going to do three things. I'll let you know what they are in advance, okay? So you're not wondering what's going to go on. They're going to take me in the back and beat me up? No. He's going to pray with you. A simple prayer to invite Jesus into your heart. You're going to be born again. Then he's going to give you some free information, some free literature, help you find out what to do next in your walk with God. Now that you're a Christian, what do? Okay? This free information will help you to find that out. It's easy reading, okay? And then thirdly, he's going to talk to you about a program we have here called Spiritual Personal Trainers. Basically, it's a friend in church who will help you to get strong in the ways of the Lord. He'll describe how it works, and then he'll let you come right back out. Now listen, we'll make a promise to you guys. Give us a year of your life sitting consistently under the teaching here at the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. We have 11 church services a week, okay? I would encourage you, get into 1, 2, 3, 5, I don't know, you know, as many as you can, okay? Consistently. If all you can get is one a week, get one a week. If you can get 2, awesome. You can get 3, man, you're going to skyrocket. And at the end of that year, for the rest of your life, you'll look around and you'll say, my goodness, I didn't know I could be this blessed. Am I telling the truth, everybody? All right, take their word for it, okay? It all starts with a spiritual personal trainer. He'll describe how it works, and they'll let you come right back out. If you guys make a left turn and follow Pastor Joel, let's give him a hand as they go. Hallelujah.
Hey, you just heard that altar call. You just wanted to give God all of your heart and all of your life. Now let me lead you simply in a prayer of inviting Jesus Christ into your heart as your Lord and Savior. In fact, why don't you just go ahead and listen to me and go ahead and close your eyes and just repeat these words after me. I'll go slow. You repeat them. Say these words. Say, Father God, I come to you in the name of Jesus. I believe that Jesus Christ is your only begotten Son and that you sent him for me and that he died for me on that cross at Calvary. I believe that his blood washes away my sins, that I am now a new creature in Christ Jesus. And I thank you, Lord. I receive you now and forever as my Lord and as my Savior. I'm going to turn from sin, and I'm going to turn with all of my heart and all of my life to you, Jesus, as my Lord and as my Savior. Let it be known in heaven as well as upon the earth that I am born again. I'm a child of God, that I'm saved, and I'm headed for heaven and denying my presence in hell. Thank you, Jesus. I'm alive forevermore. Love you so much. God bless you guys. Everybody just say amen and receive Christ as your Lord and Savior. So talk to you later. God bless you.
Thank you for listening to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. If this message spoke to you, please share it with us. We'd love to hear from you. You can find more information at www.rockchurch.com.